Okay, so I can start talking. Everybody hear me? Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. We're very happy to have you here. I'm Judy Dean. I'm the Deputy Director of TRAC, the Terrorism, Transnational Crime and Corruption Center. And we are one of the co-hosts of today's event. So we are delighted to be having this event for two reasons. First of all, because we have a wonderful speaker, the Ambassador of Colombia, Juan Carlos Pinzón, who will speak about his country, our partnership, and the political challenges that both of our countries face. And it's in honor of the 200th anniversary of U.S.-Colombian relations. But this is also a big event for TRAC because it's our first fully in-person event in the last 2 years. It's the first time. Yeah. So we are really excited at having you all here. We recognize that much of our audience is not yet comfortable being in a closed facility like this. So we will be recording this session, and we will have it on YouTube, and we'll put it up on our website and send it out to the 1,500 odd members of our listserv. So there will be a much larger audience. But I do want to thank all of you for coming, because we really appreciate it. And having people in the room just makes so much difference. So that's why we're glad to be doing this. And we hope we'll be able to continue to have in-person events. I just want to give a little background on TRAC for people who don't know us. Terrorism, Transnational Crime and Corruption Center. We are a research center at the Schar School. We focus mainly on the intersections of those three and on the illicit trades that in many cases result from them. So we have done research on human trafficking, on trafficking of wildlife, on trafficking of antiquities, on trafficking of gold, and many others. And so what we're gonna have today is we're gonna have two discussants, one from TRAC and one from the Center for Security Policy Studies. Our discussant from TRAC is Dr. Camilo Pardo-Herrera, who is currently carrying out research on illicit gold flows from Colombia and Peru to the United States. He got his doctorate at TRAC under Dr. Shelley, who unfortunately can't be with us today, but she will be listening, and she's very excited that we're having this presentation. And Camilo has done extensive work on the political economy and crime connected to natural resource extraction in Latin America, Africa, and Asia. As I mentioned a moment ago, the program is co-hosted by TRAC and the Center for Security Policy Studies at the Schar School. So I want to introduce our co-sponsor, Ellen Laipson, who is the director of the International Security Program at the Schar School and also directs the Center for Security Policy Studies. And she will introduce Ambassador Pinzón. She joined George Mason in 2017 after a distinguished 25-year career in government. She serves on a number of non-governmental boards related to international security and diplomacy. Her last post in government was as vice chair of the National Intelligence Council. And then she was the president and CEO of the Stimson Center from 2002 to 2015. Just a couple of points, housekeeping details. So we'll have the ambassador, Ellen will introduce the ambassador. The ambassador will speak, and then we will have a discussion and we can have questions. When the question time comes, we have those two mics right at either side. And we'd ask you to come up and speak in the mic because, again, this is all going to be recorded. So we want to make sure that your questions are recorded as well. So without further ado, Ellen.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Judy. And it's a pleasure to be sharing the podium with TRAC. And I'm delighted that Luis Shelley and Camilo suggested that we partner on this event. The CSPS, the Center for Security Policy Studies, is a small center that promotes collaboration of faculty and student research. But we hold a lot of student-led activities. Just this Saturday, we held an all-day simulation, a crisis simulation, where students played the roles of China, the US, and Japan on a South China Sea maritime crisis. They had to make a lot of decisions. They had to and spent the whole day sort of role-playing for an international security crisis. We do a fall symposium. This year it will be on the Arctic. and we hold also ourselves occasional speakers, so we were really delighted to partner for this today's event. You will find the ambassador, Juan Carlos Pinzón, a remarkably talented and experienced leader of both his country, but has also served at the international level in a few organizations. This is his second tour as ambassador to the U.S. He was Colombia's ambassador here from 2015 to 2017 and returned in July of last year. In between, he's been had leadership positions in a number of public and private organizations. He was the president of the Foundation for the Progress of the Capital Region, Pro Bogota, a private nonprofit for the promotion of the common good. He was the defense minister for 4 years in a critical time in Colombia's history, and I hope we'll be able to discuss with him in some depth the debates around Plan Colombia, the end of the Civil War, and the implementation of that agreement. He's been chief of staff to the president of the country. He was an advisor to the executive director at the World Bank. He's been involved in investment banking and holds degrees in economics, public policy, and defense and national security. So I think you will find a man of a remarkable range of public policy concerns and issues that are of interest to all of us, and we all look forward to learning much more about Colombia and about U.S.-Colombian relations. Welcome, Mr. Ambassador, and thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Do you listen? All right, very well. Well, thank you so much for that kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be here at George Mason University, and it becomes more interesting to know that this is the first event, gathering people again, and that's very good news just by definition. I think all of us are missing people. Certainly I am, and I'm happy to see people, and hopefully we'll gather more. Let's see how it comes, but that's very important. I feel very honored to see these two centers, both for transnational crime and for international security, to gather and to give us the opportunity to have a conversation. Of course, that will come more on the dialogue we're going to have. In the meantime, I will focus very much to tell you a little bit about Colombia. Usually, Colombia is not necessarily known as we would like to be known. Usually we're known for our history in the 90s, terrorism, drug trafficking, and all the bad things. And by the way, those are challenges that still we have not overcome completely, as you will listen in my conversation, and are challenges that we're confronting. But at the same time, Colombia is a country that has been blossoming. There are great things and great stories that are happening in the country in a way that when I see how the world sees us, once they know what's going on, there's a lot of opportunity and a lot of great things that can happen. And even the challenges we confront that are difficult, that are complex, can have a better solution if this reality of Colombia continues to move forward. And that's what I have here, and this is why I like to start with this slide that somehow presents this Colombia of natural wonders. That's the first thing I gotta tell you. We're a country of natural wonders. We are a country that certainly is a melting pot. We are multiracial, multicultural, multi-region country. And usually people doesn't think about it, but that's a little bit of what we are. And that's why we have this potential of mixing cultures, doing many things. The country is relatively large. When you see in Latin America, we are number fourth in population after the United States, Brazil, and Mexico, and we'll be number six in territory, having the size of Texas, California, and Virginia together, if you put it in perspective, even a little bit more than that. So it's quite a big country, and somehow almost half of the country is a country with still natural wonders, which means no infrastructure, but at the same time, a wonderful opportunity for conservation. But as the country is like that, then you see the other part. We're a country of cities. Most of Latin American countries will have concentrated in their capitals more than half of the population in the metropolitan areas, not Colombia. We are a country that will have at least five cities that are well above a million people, and we will have at least 10 cities with more than 300 people, and even others between 80 to 300 people, another 10 or 15. So it's quite interesting because every city you visit has different stories. You go to Medellin and you see a different story. You go to Cali and see a different story. But you go to Armenia and see a totally different. And you go to Cartagena and you get to see the wonders. But then you go to the south, to Pasto, and you will get the feeling of the Andean perception. Not to speak about Bogota, which is one of the mega cities of the world. As a metropolitan area, it's 11 million people city. And frankly speaking, is a very dynamic and diverse city. Then, of course, something that is very delicate for us Colombians today. We are in a really difficult position. Today at 6:30, and that's the good news, I will not see the game. We are playing for the World Cup. The chances are that we are not going to make it. But we will continue to fight a last fighter to the last minute and to the last second of the game. And hopefully we can make it again to a World Cup. But if not, passion of Colombia is behind our sports and our people. And somehow, as in many other countries, we really care for those things. Football is a passion. Soccer here, football for us. And the rest of the world, by the way, you know, is just to remember. Then we are a biodiverse country. According to experts, we are the most biodiverse country in the whole world in per square mile. And that's not something minor, you know. Years ago, I remember being here in school, in elementary school, many years ago, more than 4 years ago or so. And I was here and I was asked, well, every child in the room was supposed to explain in what its country was number one. And, you know, of course, our Brazilian friends, they said, well, football. And, you know, others said weapons, whatever. You know, others said roses. Well, I decided, I asked my father, and he said, well, say frogs. And I said frogs. And, well, it was true, but at the same time, it was a terrible decision because, you know, I got bullied like for 2 weeks for being the country of frogs. You know, if I'm going to be asked again, I will say the same, frogs, and not for stubbornness. I will say it because when we knew this, it was just data. Today, it is probably the future of the planet. It is probably a wealth that we don't know how big it is, because if we have more species than any other country in the world in per square mile, it implies that we even don't understand the wealth that a country like Colombia really has. So we are very proud of this. By the way, that beautiful parrot with the national colors is just to remind that in addition to frogs, we are number one in birds, you know, as well. So it's important. And finally, I like that final view because that really represents the sentiment of Colombia: cumbia, music, vallenato, culture, dance, happiness, resilience. At the times we suffered the worst violence in the world, not to forget that Colombia was the most violent country in the world by the end of the 90s. What allowed Colombia to continue to thrive, what allowed Colombia to continue to move was people, was our music, was our culture. And hopefully to the challenges that we are confronting and we will confront in the future is that stamina of Colombians about music and happiness and, you know, trying to move forward that will continue to imply a better future for us. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit about something that is important for us. We are celebrating right now 200 years of relationship between Colombia and the United States. And it is important. Why? because the first country that ever recognized Colombia was the United States. But the first republic of Latin America, when we became independent, that recognized the United States was Colombia. The first ever diplomat from Latin America that came to the United States was a representative from Colombia. So that creates a lot of ties. And somehow the bond between our countries is strong and a long time has evolved into many things, including our relationship is about people. It's not anymore government to government, diplomat to diplomat, trade to trade partner, but it's people to people. And that is going on more and more and more. When I see someone like Camilo here, that's the evidence to me. You know, Colombians are part of the U.S. community. They're part of that active life, as in other Latin American countries, somehow here to the world. But this is happening more and more often. As when I go to Colombia, I see many Americans serving in different positions and in different activities and fully connected with the country. So I think that's important to mention. Some fun facts, you know, March 18, the Foreign Relations Committee from the House of Representatives recommends Colombia to be recognized. Then June 19th, the first ever diplomat from Latin America presents its credentials to President James Monroe. A lot about the future of the Monroe Doctrine is related to the relationship with Colombia at that time. By the way, Colombia of that time was not the Colombia of today. We are Siamese brothers with Venezuela, Ecuador, Panama, part of Peru, Costa Rica, and even Nicaragua. That was the Colombia of the time. And that was what was really recognized at that time. There are interesting stories, like in 1864, the ambassador of Colombia to the United States, Manuel Murillo Toro, he was elected president of Colombia being here in Washington. Well, that's something I miss, because, you know, it will be ideal for me to compete in elections, not going to Colombia, being elected here, and then being sent, as President Lincoln did to Mr. Murillo Toro, and he sent him to Cartagena in a steamboat from the U.S. Navy. That was kind of easy at that time, in an era of no social media and no active political discussion in the media. But those facts just prove personal relations, connections between our countries. Not to forget that we had a harsh time. Panama was an issue for us. Colombia came to the United States in a very humble attitude, saying, look, we have this wonderful territory of Panama, but we don't have the troops nor the money to control everything there. So please, let's sign an agreement so you can help us to take care of Panama. And by the way, you help us to build the railroad, probably a canal in the future, so you can help us in a way to take control of our territory, but you can use it for the purpose of moving people from the East Coast to the West Coast, especially in the time of the gold rush. Well, that was the status for like 60 years. But unfortunately, by the year 1903, we got to these agreements, and Mr. Roosevelt took Panama. So that part, we didn't like it very much, and we kind of continue to disagree. But anyhow, fine, because 20 years later, there was resentment, but the United States compensated Colombia. And since then, I have to tell you, there has been only a story of great news and great issues. We worked together on the same side during the World War II. We fought together in Korea. Colombia was the only country in Latin America that sent troops to Korea. In Korea, out of 3,100 Colombians that were there, around 200 were killed in action. Around 600 were wounded. So it is a real testimony of commitment. During those years, Colombia was one of the original creators, together with the United States, of the United Nations, of the Bretton Woods institutions like World Bank and IMF, and in addition to that, the OAS was created in Bogota. So that was very important, and I think those elements really established some levels of connections that were really important. Later on, Colombia participated in peacekeeping operations in the Suez Canal in 1956 and in Sinai Peninsula since 1979. Still today, Colombian and American troops with Dutch and Fiji troops are stationed in Sinai, among others. And those are important elements because somehow show different elements of the relationship. Not to forget that Colombia sided with the United States during Cold War in a very special way. Most of the country of Latin America confronted the Cold War with dictators or some level of caudillos, not Colombia. Colombia continued to have its democracy, and even today is the longest democracy in Latin America staying in place. So that created a lot of elements that cemented higher values of democracy, freedom, respect for human rights, and somehow free markets. And that was an important addition. Later on, we had the challenges with drugs. And worse of all, was not only the cartels, but also the terrorist groups created in the 60s during Cold War era, transformed into cartels and into organizations that somehow were fully funded out of those activities. And corresponsibility did happen. Why? Because we wouldn't have that problem if here in the United States there were not the consumption of the cocaine. So full corresponsibility. We produce it by illegal groups, but there was a reason. Here's a market, even today. And of course, that created another opportunity for working together. Colombia really became in crisis by the end of the 90s, but somehow we, through Plan Colombia, frankly speaking, overcome in part those crises. We have moved forward, and we have now other challenges, including cocaine, including illegal gold, and including some territorial control, which need to be addressed, and I will not get in detail on that because certainly in our next conversation, we're gonna somehow touch base and get in depth about it. Going back to history, almost every president of Colombia has visited the United States starting in the 1930s. Not to forget that one president of the United States was ambassador to Colombia, William Henry Harrison. He was ambassador in the year 1828-1829. Some 10 years later, he was elected president of the United States, but then he died like 40 days later. 13 ambassadors of Colombia have been elected presidents of Colombia later on. So that implies a lot of connection and the importance that Colombia somehow has provided to the relationship with the United States. The first president that visited as president Colombia was President Roosevelt. In 1934, he visited Colombia, and it really made an important event for us. Not to forget, President Roosevelt was creating this wonderful policy of the New Deal, and somehow he was getting full admiration and respect all along the world. And everybody somehow wanted to implement such policies. At the same time, several missions, scientific and institutional missions, have visited Colombia. One that I remember strongly is the one in 1923, the Camero mission, that came and helped to create the central bank and the financial institutions structure as we know it nowadays. On the other side, missions like the one from Professor Schultz from Harvard University came to Colombia to discover the wonders that I described at the beginning, the biodiversity and the wonderful forests, tropical forests of Colombia. I think it's important also to mention the visit from President Kennedy. In 1961, he launched the Alliance for Progress, which probably has been, even today, one of the most successful policies in the history of the United States towards Latin America. It did happen in Bogota. So that somehow continues to prove these kind of ties and strong connections that our countries continue to have. From President Reagan onwards, every president of the United States has visited Colombia, with the exception of the previous one who sent his daughter. But other than that, every other president visited Colombia. And I think that's important. And when I put it in today's terms, President Biden, I have to tell you that President Biden has a crush with Colombia. He has been 6 times in Colombia prior to be president of the United States. He visited Colombia as the chairman and as the ranking member of the Foreign Relations Committee during the time of the creation and design of Plan Colombia, as even today, the most successful bipartisan policy of the United States in Latin America, maybe in the recent years, one of the most successful to the world. Then he visited Colombia as vice president. He helped us to get and achieve the free trade agreement. And later on, he created in Cartagena the U.S.-Colombia Business Council. So all these are elements in history that even today allows Colombia to have this strong connection with the United States, with a very specific line: bipartisanship. We have good relations with Reagan, with Bush, with President Clinton, especially one because he was the one who put together Plan Colombia as a concept, then President Bush, then President Obama, then President Trump, and nowadays, as I've described, President Biden. Colombia has moved into international arena linked about this relationship. So in 2017, we became NATO global partners. And also, by the year 2020, after 10 years of efforts, Colombia became an OECD country. So those elements have put Colombia in a special spotlight. In the recent years, we have been working, as everybody else, with COVID. So we were thankful for 6 million vaccines coming from US taxpayer, from US people, donated to Colombia. Another 2 million were donated 2 weeks ago. So we have amounted now 8. Is something that we value, we are thankful, and that has allowed Colombian economy to come back and recover. We have been leading the efforts for migration from Venezuela after a terrible dictatorship that continues to be there. 6 million Venezuelans have fled the country. 6 million Venezuelans. Out of those, 5 million have crossed Colombian territory. And out of those, 2 million live in Colombia. And we have offered a TPS status so those Venezuelans can integrate into Colombian society. This is very important, it's challenging, but it's relevant for our view. Also, during the meeting of Glasgow, Colombia became one of the leading countries in climate change policies, both on the protection of the territory and the oceans, and also on the energy transition concepts that have made Colombia the country that with Uruguay in Latin America are moving faster in terms of achieving a faster energy transition to non-traditional renewables like solar and wind power. By the way, we moved from 0.5% in the matrix on those non-traditional renewables to 14% in just a period of 3 years. So it's something remarkable, and that is going on. Finally, 2 weeks ago, in this wonderful city of Washington, D.C., first in the Oval Office, our presidents met, later on in the Cabinet Room. We're very thankful to see in the same room Secretary Blinken, Secretary Lloyd Austin, Secretary Raimondo, National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan, and other members of the U.S. Cabinet, just proving the importance of the relationship. That day, President Biden announced, and nobody better than him that has somehow pushed for Colombia, announced that Colombia was designated as a major non-NATO ally. which implies, in addition to our meal-to-meal historic relationship and, as I said, diplomatic, politically, economical, but people-to-people, another opportunity to get to the next phase after this bicentennial celebration. Of course, I do have many other slides, but I know it's very important to really establish this conversation. What I want you to know is that few things. Colombia has been very stable. It implies that in 120 years that you see there, only three times Colombia has had negative growth. And also, this graph shows that Colombia was one of the top five performers in the world in 2021 in terms of rebounding the economy up to 10.6%. Inflation is something that matters. Colombia is the only country in Latin America that has never had a hyperinflation. Most, not to say all of the major economies in the region at some point in history suffer hyperinflation, not Colombia. According to the economists and to Bloomberg, one estimates normalcy index, the other one resilience index after the pandemic. Colombia is one of the top 10 countries in the world in any metric on absorbing the pandemic and at the same time rebounding out of the pandemic. So the economy has opened again. Why we are obsessed with this in Colombia? By the way, we have a better vaccination rate than the United States. Why we're obsessed on this? Because when the economy was closed, in a matter of 3 months, more than 4 million jobs were lost. And in a country that still has fragilities coming out of conflict, coming out of crime, coming out of terrorism, with a bad neighbor that somehow promotes illegality, we really were in trouble. And suddenly, last year around this time, we start to see a social unrest that somehow was deriving in violence. And that was problematic. First, let me say it. Colombian people was right to request support. So it was to us, government, to provide to the people. They were asking for jobs. They were asking for support. They were asking for having access to education in the middle of a very terrible crisis. What was harmful was to see criminal organizations taking over of these events and somehow starting with riots but ending with terrorism, destroying the public transportation of two cities, blockading the access of food to many Colombians, and also attacking institutions like the police, among others. And that was harmful. So we knew we needed two kinds of responses. The first, recovering the economy as a main national priority. Because at the end, it's about jobs. It's about giving back to people, again, solutions. So we moved from 24% unemployment to having today around 12% unemployment. That has somehow calmed down the situation. And still, we see issues and problems and cases of intentions, but never at the level of the unrest we saw last year. And the other layer, of course, is rule of law. How to go after those who really dare to move into crime and violence against other Colombians. And on that front, of course, we are continue to work. It's something that we must. About trade and investment, I think this is important. Colombia has 17 free trade agreements. So we have access to 60 countries and 1.5 billion potential market. We're not a small country anyway. We're 51 million people. So any company likes to go and see 51 million consumers. You know, it's larger than some states of the United States together. But on the other side, the importance is that we are a platform to send exports to other countries. This is the one I like. So, you know, out of the coffee you have in the United States, 24% comes from Colombia. So the chances are that one-fourth, you know, every time you take a coffee, might be Colombian coffee. But let me tell you about roses and Valentine's Day. 64% of the roses that you see in this country come from Colombia. By the way, we love these products, not only because, of course, they bring back money to the country, but because the families that usually are working on these industries are led either by mothers, by single families, you know, single mothers, or by families from the rural areas that really have about this the opportunity to progress. Not to speak about fresh tilapia. Fresh tilapia has become a usual food here in the United States. Sometimes in sushi, sometimes, you know, you just get it in the supermarket. Most of that tilapia comes from Colombia. You know, the only thing I'm missing is who's the visionary that saw it that is really making a lot of money out of that and why we didn't, right? This is about investment. Our main investors are the US, Spain, UK, Canada, and China. This is important these days, connectivity. Colombia is a well-connected country. We have 39 million active social media users, which implies that almost 77% of the population is connected. But the other indicator is even more important. 87% of Colombians, you know, can be reached through Facebook. And that's very impressive, you know, because it's higher rates than the US and Brazil. So it shows some level of, you know, being adapted to technology with the risks that that imply. And finally, we have more cell phones than people. You know, 60 million cell phones, you know, operating in the country, which imply we're moving into the digital era. This is important. Colombia is moving into the digital economy. There are a lot of companies that are in the digital market. There are unicorns already like Rappi, and there are others that are growing fast. Not to forget that Colombia's economy size is between 50 to 60, but the fintech is number 14. What does that imply? We are a country that has young people that is adapting faster than others to the new technologies. And there's a lot of opportunity. What I've been seeing recently is US companies coming to Colombia to seek either for BPOs or for call centers, but more interesting now, for coders. Colombian coders are coding for the digital ecosystem here in the United States and to the world. And of course, that's a hopeful opportunity for us. This is something that I keep trying to insist. I am a very fortunate person for many reasons, but the one that I'm more happy about is because I know my country in detail. I have visited most of my country, like most of Colombians, I would even say, and any other people that I know. What I can tell you as a witness is we have some of the most beautiful natural wonders in the planet, including Parque del Chiribiquete, Caño Cristales, and of course the wonders of the Sierra Nevada de Santa Marta, just to mention a few. I really recommend you to see it. These are places that are unique to the world. And of course, it's a wonderful opportunity for our next economic opportunity, tourism. It was really picking up. Suddenly, we got the COVID. And of course, tourism somehow disappeared to the world. It's coming back. That's, you know, if we can solve the pandemic challenges, it's going to be a real source of opportunity for Colombians. This I mentioned before is about biodiversity and how important that is to us. This I mentioned before is historically we have been a clean energy country. 74% of our matrix comes from hydropower and natural gas. But in the recent 3 years, I explained, non-conventional renewables like wind and solar are growing really fast. I like this picture just because it reminds me and everybody in the public service why we're here, why we are in this business. Why is that we are public servants. Because of them. Because of them. You know, and I keep trying to remind ourselves and remind everybody that has this kind of job that the reason why we're here is because of them. That's our duty, providing a better future for them. And, you know, any policy we try is about them. And I think in this country, we feel there's a lot of understanding and we are sharing values and we're working on same ideas to protect democracy, to work hard on migration, and of course, to respond to the climate change challenge, among other global challenges. I think we have a beautiful future if we can keep moving forward. But as any other country, if you stop doing what you are doing and is bringing success, of course, future stops being as it can be. We have a right road if we move forward. I like to remind everybody that this is the Colombia we know these days. And this is the Colombia we really want to be reminded for. You know, the Sofias Vergaras of the world, but our singers, our sports people that is connected to the US, you know, and of course Shakira, and not to forget Garcia Marquez, and not to forget the scientists at NASA, but not to forget this week's great success of getting the first Oscar for some movie related to Colombia, and was not good news, a Narcos movie or something alike, was Encanto. It was Encanto. And somehow it's showing a light to the future of Colombia that is our people who has built it, that it doesn't imply that we don't have the challenges we have, but somehow it shows a clear path on where to move. I end with this video, if you allow me.